are people on the...
It's time to enter the world of real estate in Oahu with Hawaii's only true real estate radio show, the Team Lally Real Estate Show. Grab a pen and get ready to take notes. For the next full hour, Hawaii's premier real estate leader, Adrienne Lally, and Attilio Leonardi will bring you the latest in real estate news and real-world strategies on how they can guarantee to sell your home at a price and deadline you agree to, or they'll buy it. Now, here are your hosts, Adrienne and Attilio.
Welcome to the Team Lally Real Estate Show, home of the Guaranteed Sold program, or we'll buy it. If you have any questions, just give us a call at 799-9596 or check us out online at teamlally.com.
Hey, did you just get up this morning?
No, I've been up since.
Oh, you've been up for a while?
Yes, okay, I've been up for a while.
I just was checking on that.
Oh, thanks.
Checking on
Thank you for your concern.
But anyway, what I wanted to talk to you about is a book that I'm reading right now. This is Attilio, and this is the art part of the show. Attilio's random thoughts that are not random. They are things that I think about from show to show, in between shows for the whole week, on what can I share with our listeners that if you took that information and incorporated it into your life, that it would bring value. So there's a book that I'm reading. By the way, I don't, you know, when you listen to the books with the audiobooks, or even on the Kindle, that's how much of a purist I am when it comes to reading books. I strongly feel, and again,
it's your opinion.
Opinion, and it's our show. So if you have a dissenting opinion, then what you got to do is go get your own show. So reading books, I highly believe that if you're truly seeking knowledge and want to implement it in your life, that you should actually own a physical copy of the book. Because I tell you, when the computers start taking over the world and sending robots in air spaceships to blow us up with lasers, you'll be glad that you had a physical book, because all the digital Kindle stuff, it'll all disappear. And so,
good to know.
Tip for the next zombie apocalypse.
Yes, be prepared.
Make sure you have a physical book. I think there was like some movie where they had forgotten everything because all the computers and electricity went away. And where they found the library that was like 1,000 years old, and like, here's the information that we need. So stockpile those books. And not just any kind of books.
Good books.
Yeah.
Like this one that you're going to share.
Yes, and the title of the book is called The Infinite Game by Simon Sinek, last name S-I-N-E-K. He is the best-selling author of other books called Start With the Why and Leaders Eat Last. And it's an interesting story that he talked about. He was invited to be a speaker, at Apple's conference and at Microsoft's conference, and something he noticed was that when he was speaking at the Microsoft conference, all the presentations before him and all the presentations after him, most of them were geared towards how can we beat Apple. When he spoke at the Apple conference, what he noticed is that all the presentations before him and all the presentations after him didn't talk about Microsoft at all. It was just about focusing on creating a better products for the clients. How can we come up with better products for our customers? And so that's the difference between leadership or company ownership or an ideology or a culture within a business that's either finite-minded or infinite-minded. How can you tell? Finite-minded. He also mentions CEOs coming on board for Walmart. And something interesting he mentioned, he says, when you talk about things, like say you're going to talk about three different topics. Adrian, do you think that the first thing that you mentioned, the second thing that you mentioned, and the third thing you mentioned are in the order of how important those things are to you? Number one, you know, the most important thing you mentioned first?
I would say...
Just say yes.
Yes.
That is correct. Well, no. Tell me what you were thinking.
Well, I mean, I was thinking that maybe that first topic is something that's I don't want to say necessarily the most important, but maybe it's just the most urgent, or could be like a time sensitive.
Yeah.
So there's different reasons to bring up things first.
That's true. Mm-hmm. What he was saying was he was noticing the introductory speeches for these two CEOs for Walmart.
Mm-hmm.
The one that he didn't think was going to do well was very management orientated. They're just like, we have good management systems. We're going to increase profit. We're going to bring value to our shareholders. And then the last thing he talked about is creating a better experience for our employees and our customers.
Mm-hmm.
The next CEO, who's doing a little bit better for Walmart, flipped it around, because when Sam Walton started from zero to build Walmart, do you think his whole thing about like, let's make a lot of money? And what do you think Sam Walton's dream was, or his goal?
Was to provide, you know, a great price and great products to the community.
Yeah, good jobs for his staff, mm-hmm. and good service for his clients. That's why Walmart grew to its biggest and has fluctuated and had challenges with CEOs that didn't keep that in mind, mm-hmm. and CEOs that did. Speaking of the CEO that keeps our clients and the staff of his company numero uno all the time and just keeps expanding and growing, who do we have, Adrian?
We've got Duke Kim Han. Hawaii Pacific Property Management.
With his infinite leadership.
That's right.
Wow, that's an amazing intro.
Yeah.
I was wondering how it was going to be tied into all these Walmart CEOs.
Exactly. So you're building what Sam Walton wanted, was just better experience for property owners. I mean, I hear you talk about it all the time.
Mm-hmm. It's always top of mind.
Yeah.
My philosophy in business is to always balance sales and service.
Yes.
So I wanted to talk about that real quick.
Okay.
So with the front of the house, you know, the people that are out there, the property managers, myself, people that talk about advertising and do all of our advertising for us, they're the front. They're the front people that talk to the guests, talk to the owners, talk to the tenants. But then you have the back house services that handle all the maintenance. Of course, they handle, you know, anything that you might call if you have a question, rent collection, and all that stuff. Most of that is moved automated right now. But for the most part, sales and service, if one is all out of balance, the company will not do well.
Yeah.
Think about that. So if your sales are great and your service can't handle it, if you're selling a bunch of cars and you can't service these cars, the customer will go away.
Mm-hmm.
So on the other side, if you're not selling cars and you can service them well, doesn't matter. You'll go out of business just the same.
Yeah.
So I want to make sure that our services behind the scenes are just as seamless as our services in front of the scenes, you know, where people can see you. And it's a big deal to balance that, because as you move forward in business and you grow, you'll find that any one time you'll be out of balance and you'll feel it right away.
Well,
customers that call us up will say, hey, I'm not getting a call back. And that's one of our guarantees to call you back. Or they're not getting something that they signed up for. And that bothers me.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I know that your back of the house and your admins are very, very concerned and meeting every week to make sure that this is balanced and the support is there.
Well, they're very proactive.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Duke, what I loved about you guys and you've shared it with us is the surveys that you do for the owners.
Mm-hmm.
And I was amazed at how much depth of the questions and the response that you're getting from them. And what I really like is, so when you get those survey results, Duke, what do you guys do with the survey results?
Well, of course, we read them, interpret them, mm-hmm. and see if there's anything that we're not doing or was misunderstood.
Yes.
One of the biggest challenges we have is to make sure the message runs all the way from me to the customer and the customer understands it. So in our surveys, we say one of the questions is, do you need Duke to give you a call? Because as you grow as a company, it's easy to talk and brag about all the services we have, but delivering them is a whole another half of the ballgame. And I take all of that balance very seriously, because sometimes the admins will come to me and say, hey, we're too busy. We can't get to it. The phone's ringing. We can't get to it. We have too many files on our desk. That's a good time to say, you got to hire.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we have a whole staff of people that are just virtual online. Although they do have 808 numbers, they're not here in the United States. But yeah, they work tirelessly to make up for that. And I got to tell you that the staff, of course, they're much younger than me.
Yeah.
They're so good on the computer that you got to use them for their strength.
Now, Duke, speaking of growing and time to hire, are you guys currently looking for any talent right now?
You know, when talent comes to you, you can't say no. So sometimes I've hired when we don't need talent.
Mm-hmm.
And you just don't want that talent to be walking around the street to work for your competitor.
Well,
we're always looking for talent.
I think what I like about you guys is the way that you set it up, too, that person can come in and build their own business. It's not like you're a coal factory and you only got so many coal for coal miners.
Well, you'll make room for talent.
You guys make coal.
That's right.
They can go out there and go get their own coal, make their own mine, because you give them all the tools to go and do it. So they can build their book of business if they're a talented person, right?
Yep, absolutely.
Yeah. Last thing I want to share with our listeners. We were talking earlier and you said that you guys are punching through. And it's not because you're upset and you're busting through a wall. It's because you're expanding your office. So there's the proactiveness I want to talk about. So how many times have you expanded the office to from where you started to where you're at now to where you're going to be?
Three
times.
Wow.
So.
And I'll tell you, that growth is strictly due to doing what we say and saying what we do and guaranteeing your work. You know, it really amazes me that no one else on this island guarantees their work for property management. And so it's going to come down to if you can get this service, this company for that amount, or that company for that amount, one's guaranteeing their work and the other is not guaranteeing their work, then, you know, it's product.
You got to make a decision.
It's an easy choice.
We have a good product. We pick up our product, and I'm accessible at all times to make sure that we adhere to the product and that everybody has the same motion and vision.
And I think, too, what's good about how the culture you've created there for your team is that, you know, if a client calls you directly, it's not like anybody's getting in trouble. It's just feedback that you can help make a correction to.
So on all of our contracts, you have direct contact with me or 17 other people on our staff. You can call anybody anytime. We're all available and everybody answers their phone in my company.
Yeah. It's nobody's getting anybody in trouble. Nobody's making waves. It's just feedback for the company to take corrective
action. Well, that's the culture, though.
Yes.
That's the culture of answering your phone, returning calls, like the culture of communication.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Duke.
You know, when I mentor new realtors, I say, here's rule number one, answer your phone.
Rule number two, see rule number one.
All right, thank you.
Thanks, Duke. Thank you, Duke, for his team for always answering their phones. Don't take our word for it. You know, a reflection of how they treat their customers is in the reviews.
That's right. So check them out. Actually, check out their website, hipacificpm.com. You can give them a call at 445-9223.
Next up, we got a special individual. He's a superstar coming all the way over. He sat on a volcano, was blown up into the sky, and landed all the way on Oahu on our show today. He is the man, the myth, the legend. He is Mr. Big Island. He's the FBI from Big Island. Who is it, Adrian?
We have Dan.
Dan from Keller Williams.
That's right. What do you got for us this week, Dan?
Hey, guys. How are you?
Good. What's the latest over there? What's going on?
Well, it's warm. The summer definitely hit here about 30 days ago.
Yeah.
I mean, up to that point, we had probably one of the coolest summers.
Nice.
That I can remember. But about a month ago, summer really kicked in. It's been dry and it's been warm. So it would be ideal if you could go to the beach, but you can't.
Yeah.
Right?
You get to go jump in the water. You know, it's
exactly. Well. Yeah, and so the last time we talked last week, since then, Mayor Harry Kim has continued to keep the state and public and county beaches closed.
But you can go in the water?
So you can. You can walk across the beach like we did during COVID. Mm-hmm. You can exercise, but you can't park yourself on the beach, and he's going to keep that in place until October 1st.
You like the tourists with the sensitive feet, and the sand is like all hot, and you're like, ow, 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 and you just jump in the water.
So that's exactly right.
So Dan, I have a question on, I know that you are physically located in Kona. However, you know, there's agents in both Hilo and Kona.
Yes. Uh-huh.
So we were actually talking with Duke earlier today, whose brother lives
in Hilo.
He's actively, you know, buying up properties and building properties over in Hilo. He just said that it's the market's just, there's such a low inventory. What's
the lava flow? He was saying that the lava flow's kind of wiped out a couple homes and stuff, so it's creating shift in demand.
Just displaced a lot of families.
Yeah, into Hilo, and so the rental market's super tight, and as well as inventory. What are you seeing there on the street?
Yeah, I would agree. In fact, you know the old saying that all real estate is local.
Yes,
and I would say it's even hyper local. If you take a look at the stats for Kona. And in and around Kona, I mm-hmm. think we're only off by about five sales from this time last year.
Wow.
So to say that there's been any dip in the market in Kona from last year would be wrong. There really hasn't. We are that close to the same stats as last year. Now, take that and drive down Queen K all the way to the resorts, and you'll see that the market's off by about 16%.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but that would go part and parcel, right? I mean, people who are in Kona most likely are primary residents, moving from one primary residence to another. But if you go out to the resorts, Waikoloa Beach, Mauna Lani, Hapuna, all of that area, that place is all second homes, and they haven't. Not only have they not been able to come, but they can't vacation rental them . And so sales have been slow there, and they're off by about 16%. You move up to Waikoloa Village, different story. Again, better statistics. They're not that far off from last year. But Waikoloa Village up at the top of the hill is more of a primary market and less of a secondary market.
Yeah. Do you guys have – are they coming up – are they doing bubble resorts
in the Big Island? On Kauai. Yeah. They had an announcement on the tenders.
Yeah. Yeah. I have not heard about that being done here. I've seen it on the news. I've heard other islands talking about it, but I don't think that conversation is going on here. Now, I just left a lunch where I was having a conversation with a luxury builder of mine.
Mm-hmm.
And for those who are not with Keller Williams or haven't been a part of Keller Williams, last week we had one of our two annual conferences a year called Mega Camp. And I was watching the presentation from Gary Keller on Mega Camp, and he was talking about the economic conditions. And one of the things that jumped out at you in his presentation was those people in the upper price range, the upper bracket, have really been not affected by this pandemic whatsoever. I mean, their life really hasn't changed all that much. And it certainly hasn't from an economic standpoint. The people who have been disproportionately hurt are people on the lower end of the market, right?
Yeah.
So hotel workers, hourly wage people, and so forth. So when I'm having lunch with this luxury builder who builds a lot of homes out in Kukio, Hualalai, Mauna Lani, he tells me at lunch today that, you know, his list of projects is so long, he couldn't possibly hire enough people to do all of the work that he has
for construction.
Wow.
Yeah.
For construction.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We heard even here in Oahu, the it's super tight. The labor market is super tight right now. Everybody's working because it's essential, and real estate's booming. So it's good news. So maybe you got to, instead of cleaning rooms, you got to go learn how to swing a hammer.
That's right.
So,
it wasn't so long ago. And I would say, you know, definitely pre-COVID and maybe a little further back, where you would be selling what we call in the business, selling a piece of dirt, right? You're selling a lot. Some people call it selling a brown square, right? And you would go meet with the seller of the piece of dirt and you'd say, well, you know, this is kind of a tough sell because, you know, people are kind of adverse to building. It's a long process. It's more expensive than resale. Mm-hmm. A lot of people don't have the patience for it. And a lot of people don't have the vision of kind of what could be and what should be. And so selling a piece of dirt obviously can be a much greater challenge than selling a resale home. I think that conversation now is off the table.
Yeah.
Based on what I heard today at lunch, his phone is ringing off the hook with people who say, you got a piece of dirt? Because I'm ready to build. I'll go ahead and build. I don't care how long it takes. I'm not really concerned about how much it's going to cost.
Wow.
You know?
Wow. That's good news.
People are building. And they're not afraid.
So if you got mud pies for sale, people are buying. They want the dirt. So
why would, you know, the question is, why would they go in that direction? And the answer is to what you asked me at the beginning of the conversation. There's not enough inventory, and the inventory that's currently on the market isn't meeting their needs. They're also not optimistic that more inventory is going to come on the market, and they're probably right.
Yeah.
And so they're looking to build.
Well, Roy Rogers said it best, buy land, they ain't making any more of it.
That's
except
right.
On the Big Island. You guys still making little bit land over there every once
in
a while.
Yeah, no, we are. This is the only place that is. Yeah,
and,
right?
It's the only part. It's the only place, period, in the entire United States that's actually creating more land is the Big Island. So,
yeah.
All righty.
Well, thank you, Dan.
Thank you, Dan.
For that perspective from the Big Island. We appreciate it.
You bet, guys. Have a great week.
You too. All right. So we have a special guest just calling in to share some experiences. But something about this guest is she's actually built two homes.
Built two homes. So she knows how to do that.
Yes.
So what we did was we hired her and then we gave her like a fake leash, fake dog. And we told her, go walk in this park and see what happens.
No.
And no, we didn't do that.
Well, we were talking about the situation last week and you know, said, oh, well.
Let's get our perspective.
Let's get it straight. Jessica.
Jessica is like, she's not our man in the street because she's a woman. So she's our woman in the street, just like a news reporter.
Mm-hmm.
So take us back to the scene of the situation, Jessica. Hi, Jessica. Jessica?
After that setup, right?
Hi, Adrian and Natalia. Can you hear me?
We can hear you.
Now we can hear you. So Jessica, take us back to the scene of the situation. I don't want to say like scene of the crime because that's me and Holly setting it up. But
it kind of was the scene of the crime.
Okay.
Apparently, as the state goes. But what happened was they had just announced that the parks were open for solo activity. The beaches and the parks were open. So I said, you know, the dogs have been cooped up. I decided I'm going to walk my dog in the park.
Mm-hmm.
So we went down to Heia Park over there. It's about 2 acres on the baseball field. And when it's not in use as a baseball field, it's actually an off-leash dog park or an on-leash dog park.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So I went over there by myself. I specifically left my kids at home because I knew that was a no-no because that would not be solo. And I wasn't there but 10 minutes. Before an officer approached me and said, there was one other woman in the entire park with her dog.
Yeah.
And he looks at me and says, is that your relative? And I said, no, I don't know that woman. And he says, well, you were gathering.
You were gathering.
I said, yeah. And I said, how was I gathering? And he said, well, you were over there by her. And I said, the only time I was even within 20 feet of her is when my dog got away from me and ran over there.
Yeah.
And I said, you know, this is unfair. It's unjust. And he said, well, you can take that up with the judge. He didn't want to hear what I had to say. There was no arguing. It was very upsetting.
Yeah. Did you hear like any music in the background? What they gonna do when they no. With what you're describing, it almost sounds like, man, were you being punked? I mean, was there video cameras in the bushes? Is this for real? But that's for real.
And the thing is, it was for real. And it was just appalling to me to think I was just at Costco the day before with hundreds of people within sometimes 2 feet of me.
Yeah.
And not to mention, let me, you know, set the tone here too. I was also wearing my mask. So it wasn't like I was just out there willy-nilly.
You violated
everything I was supposed to do. Yeah. Exactly. I mean, that's what they make you feel like.
Yep.
But it's just baffling that you can go into a store and be surrounded by hundreds of people, yet I can't go to an open 2-acre park with my dog with one other person on the other side of the park. Yeah. It just doesn't make sense.
There's a lot of contradictions that are going on right now, and I can see where people are getting upset. So this is what we talked about on the show last week. You know, Adrian was sharing this with me. I'm like, let's get Jess on the show. By the way, to give you some more context, Jess is your husband, awesome husband, Bill. Both of you guys run a small business. You guys are small business owners. Thank goodness you guys are essential business because you guys do construction. And
they've built their two homes.
Not small kind homes either.
Like big, beautiful homes.
Big, beautiful homes, good quality jobs there. And you were, you trained, you got your license, you're on our team, but COVID hit and your hubby's getting swamped. So you did the good thing and helped him with the business, take care of your family. So I just want to give people context. Jess isn't just somebody we're calling randomly. I'm like,
this is someone we've known for many years.
Many years. We trust Jess, and she's given us the straight skinny. Well,
I think that this is going to be a very common story. Yeah. I think over 50,000 of these citations have been issued, is my understanding.
Now, I gotten tickets before, and they put a little check mark next to the HRS rule or blah, blah, blah. I'm just curious, what was checked on there? Like congregating? HRS 5432 congregating?
There was an HRS, and then there was another number that was on there. I think, Section 6 maybe. And I mean, I actually printed it all out because when I go to court, because it's a must appear. It's not like you just mail in your $50 or your $100. Appear. It's a must appear. So now I homeschool my kids because of the distance learning. So now I have to break away from that or drag them with me to the courthouse and gather over there before I sit before the judge to plead my case. It just, none of it makes sense.
Is there a dollar amount on the fine? Is it printed there?
No.
It just must appear.
There's no dollar amount. So, I mean, I don't know what that's going to look like either.
Yeah.
It's going to be like a mob scene over there.
We were hearing that, There's what we know, and then there's all the stuff. And, you know, granted, it's all speculation. We're not, are we talking with a public information officer from HPD? No. Are we talking with the mayor or the governor? No. Well, we've been seeing or hearing that there's like thousands of these tickets that have been written.
I've heard 50,000.
50,000?
Probably more now, because I think that was the other day that they said 50,000. Mm-hmm. There's probably like 60,000 now.
Yeah.
They were writing like thousands a day.
And I heard there were like quotas, because we know. Come on, we know that there are certain times when, like, every motorcycle officer and HPD officer is on the street with the radar guns, nabbing you. Because, the mayor says, it's so weird because I think the fines for the tickets don't even go to the city and county of Honolulu. I think they go in the general fund for the state. I could be wrong.
Could be going to the rail. Who knows?
Could be going to the rail, whatever.
Or they could be lining somebody's pockets. Who knows?
Well,
it's hard to say.
We understand, too, that there's CARES Act money that's going to get use it or lose it. And so more money is being spent on overtime for HPD. We get it. Now, this is not bash HPD because
they're doing what they're told.
When some crazy nut job is busting in your front door, you're going to be glad that HPD is there to come take away the bad guys. So kudos to them. And we shouldn't be speeding because we just get into accidents. And we need to get all these junk people off the roads. So I think, a lot of it, too, I think these HPD officers are put in a position where, I don't know, what was your sense of this guy? Like, you know what? I'm writing the ticket no matter what. Like, no.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. Like, he didn't even let me, say my side of the story. And it didn't matter. He was writing the ticket. And the other woman actually got a ticket, too, because as I was walking away, I saw him call her over.
Yeah.
So we were both ticketed, And, it did seem like he was just doing what he was told to do. It wasn't like, I don't think he necessarily wanted to, but I think it's like an invasion of freedom. I can't breathe fresh air. I mean, I understand there's a real disease out there. I was taking precautions. I was being responsible. I didn't even bring my kids.
Yeah.
And I still get, tagged for it.
They're calling it a pandemic. But, we've got another top 10. It's called Pandummy. This is like Pandummy stuff. Ticketing people, walking their dogs, wearing a mask with a complete stranger. I thought, when I heard it, I was like, more than 20 feet away. You're walking at the park and they're like, I'm giving you a ticket for congregating. And you're looking all the way around. You're like, who? Oh, that guy way over there. You see him way over there. That guy.
God, I couldn't believe it.
Yeah.
I'm so sorry, Jessica, that this happened.
Yeah, I know. It's just unfortunate. And I'm all for HPD. Yes. I'm all for police in general. I think they're there to serve and protect. Mm-hmm. I just think in this situation, I don't know what's going on, but they need to figure out, they need to figure something out and make it a little bit, you know, more fair.
Well, and then
a different approach.
I think, too, just to give HPD,
a different approach,
the officers a little support in that it's, you know, they you're in an organization where you have commanding officers, subordinates, and so forth. So HPD, it's not they're out there willy-nilly doing whatever. It's coming top-down. It's coming from the governor to the mayor to the, you know, police chief and then all the way down the rank. So a lot of times these guys are like, I got to do what I got to do, else I'm going to lose my job and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So,
an unfortunate position for them to be
they're
in.
Just, they're the bad guys in the middle between rules and or laws that might be in the pandemic category.
Might be.
As opposed to the pandemic category.
I think they are in the pandemic.
But it's tough. It's tough. I'm still going to give the mayor and the governor, man. I just, I would not want to be in those positions right now. That's that's tough.
Yep.
It's tough, but we got to spread some a little common sense. I would just tell all the HPD officers, like, you know what? Let's go after the nut job that's just running through Walmart screaming and yelling at people and saying, I don't want to wear a mask. Let's go take that guy down. But not poor Jessica.
Or like big parties.
Big parties. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I understand like big gatherings, like social gatherings, that kind of thing. I get it. Like there has to be rules and regulations. But you can't just go picking on like single people who aren't even breaking any of the ordinance, you know? I mean, I just really felt that I was treated unfairly.
Would you?
And now I have to try and plead my case and prove to the judge, which I mean, you know, I'll do what I can.
Yeah.
And hopefully he'll see that I was not in the wrong.
Yeah.
Well, I'll be interested to hear how this all turns out.
Yeah, we need an update.
So we'll have to do an update.
Yes, we'll do an update with Jessica.
We got second date update. We got second ticket update.
That's right.
All right. It's sometime in November. So
we'll have you back
on. We'll get in touch. Yep, that sounds great.
All right.
Thanks, Jessica.
Thanks, Jessica.
And thanks for having me.
Stop congregating, okay? Tell your kids, you know, when your kids come over here and they're bugging you and they're getting on your nerves, just say, stop congregating. Go clean your rooms.
All right.
Or else I'll tell them I'll call the police.
There you go. All right. Thank you, Jessica.
Okay, thank you. Take care.
You too. All right, we're going to take a real short break. But when we come back, we have a very special guest who's going to join us and talk about bugs.
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 Are you selling your home and looking for a way to leverage the highest price? Adrian and Attilio's superior marketing creates demand, which results in homes selling for the highest price. In fact, they're so confident in their marketing strategy, they guarantee to sell your home at a price and a deadline you agree to, or they'll buy it. After hearing about Team Lally's superior marketing, Curtis and Carrie listed their Eva Beach home with them. Adrian and Attilio turned to their huge database of buyers. The result? Their home sold for $550,000, which allowed them to move on with their lives. Adrian and Attilio's home selling system is on a whole different level than the average agent, since they spend tens of thousands of dollars on marketing to get your home sold fast and for the most money possible. These are just a few more reasons why I would call my friends Adrian Lally and Attilio Leonardi of Team Lally Real Estate Group of Keller Williams, Honolulu. Give Team Lally a call today at 799-9596. That's 799-9596. Or online at teamlally.com. That's teamlally.com.
Hey, it's Sean Hannity here, and I know the business climate has changed dramatically, but if you need to sell your home, don't believe the myth that homes aren't selling. Joining me now is a true expert at selling homes, Adrian Lally and Attilio Leonardi of Team Lally Real Estate Group of Keller Williams, Honolulu. So what's your advice on selling a home right now?
Sean, our real estate team has always been on the cutting edge with technology. We're using FaceTime for showing homes with buyers and keeping our buyers and sellers safe with a virtual showing at any time and any place. We've sold hundreds of homes this way.
So what does that mean for sellers?
Sean, ignore the fake news. This is an incredible opportunity for sellers. Supply has plummeted. Demand has skyrocketed. People still have to move. We have thousands of motivated buyers ready to buy. We eliminate the tire kickers, conduct the virtual showing safely, quickly, and conveniently to sell their homes.
All right, thanks so much. Look, talk to the agent that I trust for the best advice. Call Team Lally now at 799-9596. Online at 808GuaranteedSale.com.
The Team Lally Real Estate Show continues. Give it to me, I'm worth it.
Welcome back, and thanks for listening to the Team Lally Real Estate Show, home of the Guaranteed Sold program. Who will buy it? I'm Adrian.
And I'm Attilio.
And if you have any questions, just give us a call at 799-9596 or check us out online at teamlally.com.
Hey, our next guest coming up, he was a Formula One race car. He's run more Formula One races than any other race car driver on the planet or alive today. His first name is John. His last name is Speed. No, he's not a Formula One race car. What does John do?
He is the owner, founder of Kilauea Pest Control.
Yes.
And he's coming to us to give us an update on the bugs.
He's going to be talking about bugs, or how other people say it. Pests.
Pests.
That's how, I mean, why not? It's P-E-S-S-S. Pests. Hey, brah, you get pests. Call John.
Kilauea. Kilauea Pest.
Kilauea. John, so tell us about, John, local style, we'd like to get to know you a little bit. You are not a Formula One race car, but I was going there because your last name is Speed.
Well, he's pretty fast, like with the running, though.
Yeah.
I see him out. Well, yeah. I don't see him, but I see on like social media posts with the with the running.
So, John, tell us your origin story. How did you, how did you get into the pest control business?
The origin story. Yeah. So I was going to school out here at BYU Hawaii, and back in the day, and this is many years ago, 20 years ago or so, but that was kind of the heyday of starting door-to-door pest control programs.
Wow.
And so my brother got me into the door-to-door scene in Southern California. So I went to school here in Hawaii, and then I'd go to Southern California and go sell pest control. And I always thought, oh, man, I wish I could have a pest control company and people would call me to get their pest control done and I didn't have to go knock some doors. So anyway, I did that for 4 years and then started up a business here in Hawaii. And it's been great. It's my wife and I met here. We're both on the mainland, but our kids have grown up here and we love it. And
Do you guys door knock? Or no door knocking?
We do a little bit. We haven't done any in the past few years.
Yeah.
Probably 3-4 years. But I have hired door-to-door guys. And I have a son, not my oldest son, but my middle son, the 13-year-old, is very keen on going and knocking some doors.
Oh, good.
And,
I think that's a good...
So, yeah.
I think it's a good skill set. You're out there competing, with the Mormons, the Jehovah's Witness, the Girl Scouts,
right,
with the cookies,
exactly.
Photovoltaic guys. I mean, that's your typical. Oh, and then you always got the defensive football players from the local high school selling porgy sausage.
Well, right. Not recently, right. Though.
There not recently,
there
though.
There hasn't been people out there door knocking because
I had the census.
Thing.
The census was out. Hey, if you guys haven't filled out your census, it's required by law. Come on, fill out your census. But she came to my door. You know what? She didn't come to my door for me. She came to my door for my neighbor.
Hmm.
What's up with your neighbor? Like, only got 5 cars over there. Somebody's home. Nobody answering. What do you mean? They're ducking down. Oh, it's the census person. Duck down. Get behind the curtains. So, but, I did door knocking, aluminum siding, and cable TV back in my college days.
Oh, wow.
And I thought it's a good test of persistence. So I'm happy that your 13-year-old is looking forward to wanting to do that because I think it teaches you a lot.
It takes a special person.
Yeah.
It really does. And you learn some skills that you won't learn anywhere else.
Mm-hmm. And you get these.
And you're right.
You get build up these pads on your knuckles.
Yeah.
Calluses on your knuckles. But
You do.
What you were saying, John?
It's a good skill set to have, and like I say, where it came from basically is all these. You're right; it's these Mormon kids that go out and knock doors for 2 years on their mission, and then they can go knock, for a summer and make some pretty good money. And that's how I got into it. I served a mission for my church,
nice.
and then went and knocked doors. And I remember visiting my brother the first summer he was doing it, and I was like, "Dude, I will never do that. That is for suckers." And he is such a good sales guy. He sold me on doing it. And then the next year after I got done, I was like, "Dude, I will never do that again." But the money was so good. I had to do it, again. And then, And then I have another brother that actually has a solar company here in Hawaii, and he has a team of, you know, a dozen or more guys that are knocking doors for the solar, for the photovoltaic.
Yeah. So,
well, I think it's like doing the things that others are not willing to do is partly why you guys are, you have grown so much and are so successful, right?
Yeah. I had a classmate who graduated with me in high school, and he was Mormon, and he was doing his mission in a small town in the middle of nowhere, and he just struck up a conversation with that person, and that person knew me. And it was like,
really?
Yeah, I was like, what are the odds? I was like, yeah, you know so-and-so. I was like, I know so-and-so. Yeah, that's Atilio from Hawaii. And so it was interesting. But my hat's off to anybody for whatever reason that goes out there and knocks on people's doors. I especially like it when the guys come by and they're like, because you guys always would say, is there anything I can help you with? So I'm like, you know what? I never took advantage of the guys because they were so nice to come by my house once a month and hit my mower and get the, no.
You're terrible.
Yeah. No.
So speaking
but they're
of,
there to serve.
So speaking of serving and helping, you know, one of the things that, you know, I had reached out to John earlier this month because we have a client that had purchased a Centricon system from another big company that has poof gone away, out of business, gone. And you know, I wanted him to come on and kind of talk about that, like, you know, how they can serve and help these families that are kind of orphaned right now.
And the other thing too, I want to point out the reason probably why John, you and your company aren't necessarily door knocking right now, because you guys are busy. That means you guys are providing great service.
Mm-hmm.
Great
We're
service.
Super busy.
Yeah.
We are super busy, very blessed. And, you know, I'm focused on, honestly, focused on providing jobs.
Yes.
You know, there's a lot of people out there without jobs. And fortunately, we're a business that's essential and growing. You know, there's a couple of companies that kind of specialize on the commercial side. And I think they've probably taken a hit or two, but still people are home and seeing the bugs and getting bit and doing all these home projects that sometimes include taking out for birds or, you know, obviously rodents or, you know, even some of the more things you don't think about that just need to get done is like the big termite jobs. And of course, the real estate market is still screaming, you know, not a whole lot of inventory, at least over on the east side here, but
it's island wide.
But
I have your bird specialist is coming to my house on Tuesday. We have a whole plan. Yes, we've got a plan.
Yeah, you've even
all the poop on my cars. I just couldn't take it anymore.
I forgot the name of your guy, but he came by the other day to my place because I think I get like quarterly or something or monthly pest control. But he knocked on the door, super polite. Let me know what he was doing. I'm one of those wacky people. I don't have piles of junk all the way around my home, so he probably loves treating my home because he can just go right around the perimeter. He even, you know what he did? He moved the doormats away so he didn't nuke my doormats. So he scooted them back
and then
sprayed up because you're trying to create a barrier, I guess, right, between the outside and the inside on the pests.
Yeah.
And he even said, do you want me to come inside the house to do any special spots? And I was like, no, everything's good. And but I know I've like sometimes I said, yeah, can you just do the garage for me? But I'm not one of those hoarders where like, okay, I can't even see your back wall of your garage. So you people, you hoarders, don't be asking them to come treat the garage when stuff's piled left, top to left and back to right because they're not not going to squeeze in between. But he was very polite. Even let me know when he was ready to leave and what he did and some extra stuff that he caught in one area. And that was it. It was awesome. Good
Perfect.
Service. Yep.
Perfect. Thank you. Thank you for the feedback. And again, we're just trying to, you know, educate as much as we can and try to help people help themselves as far as, you know, letting them know if there's, you know, a mud tube coming up the side of your house and you're getting termites or, you know, avenues of entry for rodents or whatnot. Just little things we can try to help out with. But no, that's great to hear.
Well, I always put in my request too that if you guys could come up with some type of fumigant that I can spray over the fence when my neighbors are doing horrible karaoke late at night.
You know,
just knock them out. They wake up the next morning. They just felt like, oh, I probably just had a couple too many Heinekens. And then that's it.
No more singing.
Fumigant for bad karaoke. That's always my request.
Yeah.
So, John, you
I think that's why the...
Go ahead.
I think that's why the other company, had to close down for stuff like that.
But. Yeah, maybe they were taking those requests and doing that. Yeah, so.
Yeah. So John, you mentioned that you guys are super busy and you're, focused on keeping people employed. Are you looking for talent? Are you looking to grow your team?
Yeah.
We absolutely are. And in fact, it's kind of funny because when they're contacting me about advertising, the TV stations or whatnot. And it's like, we're okay on the advertising for the business, but I'm just kind of interested in, all the talent out there, and the people that need jobs, and you got the federal funds that are kind of going away and, families.
Unemployment.
Unemployment and whatnot. And so, just to see, what kind of talent's out there, because it's kind of a unique place that we're in that we can hire, and we have a great team, already, and we're just always looking to add to that, just to up our game, be the best we can be.
I think right now we are in a kind of unusual situation where there's a lot more talent on the market that normally would normally be employed.
Or if you're for example, or they know something's coming down the pipe, because like if you're at Hawaiian Airlines, thousand furloughs coming down the pipe, you're wondering, I wonder if I'm one of them.
Well, I think that they were given their notice already.
They were?
Yeah, I saw something on Instagram someone had posted.
So,
one of those people, John's hiring.
Well, go ahead, John.
Oh, I was just going to say, pest control is not sexy. Don't think of, I want to be, it's a dirty job, Think about, hey, I want to be a pest control guy when I go. I'm not thinking about that. But as it turns out, pest control is an incredible job. It's so interesting. I'm always learning things. I'm getting to meet people. Yeah. And I get to, for me, I like seeing kind of cool homes and meeting, customers. And it's not hard. It's not a lot. We'll have a lot of contractors, or not contractors, but union guys are guys that make a lot more money elsewhere, but are kind of older, and their bodies just can't do all the cement and everything anymore, and they'll come over to us and they're so stoked because it's just pretty, I wouldn't say easy, but it's pretty smooth job. I did the tech work for 5 or 6 years when I started the business, and if that's all I had to do, I'd love to do that again.
Sure.
I mean, I just like going out and meeting people, and it's people want to see you.
Well, and I think
you're visiting. The hero.
You're the hero. You're visiting, and then I think even now with more people working from home or remote, that you're more likely to see homeowners now, and then they see you, and
people want to connect, right? Yeah. Especially after all the home sheltering, it's like, who knows the last time they had like a conversation with somebody?
Yeah,
right. Yep, absolutely. And right now, that is the highest concern. Really, is just keeping our people and our customers safe, because we are in homes, and so we have during this time. Tried to stay out of homes as much as possible, and it's pretty good because right now, most and this is something that comes up. I know there's companies that only do quarterly service.
Yeah,
and we offer quarterly service, and it depends on the place sometimes. But but I usually like a every other month service, every 2 month service.
Yeah.
If you do a good outdoor treatment, that'll keep us from having to come back in.
Yes.
Which doesn't cost the homeowner anything extra. But it's just more headache for you and us. If we can just do a good outdoor treatment and you never see bugs inside, rather than quarterly, where there's a better chance that you may see something inside, then to me, like, hey, if you're paying for pest control, you might as well,
So every other month.
Do it right.
Yeah.
Every other month, and at the same time, I think monthly is probably a little too much.
Yeah.
Except if you have ticks or if it's a restaurant or something like that. But
gotcha.
But it depends on the house too. And sometimes after you know, a few years, people like back off to quarterly.
Yeah.
And yeah, so it's a prescription treatment, mm-hmm. and it depends on so many things, you know, or if you have pets or if you have kids. And, you know, like, you know, people have kids and they eat in the car and then there's roaches all over the car. And
yeah.
It's going back and forth to the house. And so we take a proactive approach where, you know, there's a couple of things that are extra, like termites or mm-hmm. bed bugs, something specialty like yeah. birds. Mm-hmm. But for the most part, most everything's included in the service.
Gotcha.
And so it's kind of nice because it's one price, and then whatever we need to do to make your home pest-free is taken care of.
Yeah, so if you listeners are out there, want to give you guys a call, what's the best number? I got the 236-2847.
236-BUGS.
236-BUGS. And it's KilaueaPest.com. Give people the backstory, because we're always like, oh, wow, you named your company after Kilauea.
After the volcano.
After the volcano. But it's just
after
a play.
After the volcano.
But it's a play on words, right?
But it's a play on words, and it's we kill away a pest.
Kill away a pest. That's it.
Yeah.
All right.
Didn't. Awesome.
That's like a Hawaiian and English word mashup. Kill away a pest.
I love it. Okay. Well, thank you. Thank you, John, for joining us. We need to have you on
Absolutely.
More often. It's always great to hear from you. And yeah. Congratulations on all the success, and hopefully you have some talent that contacts you after hearing the show.
Yeah, so you got two websites. If you go anywhere west of Aiea, it's Kilauea Pest with the extra S on the end. And if you go on east side, it's Kilauea Pest with a T on the end.
Just kidding. And now I have to go get that domain.
Oh, bro, I got plenty of pests. You can come visit. Yeah, we'll be right there. Okay.
Thanks, John.
Thank you, John.
Thank you. All right, aloha.
All right. So again, that was John Speed, the owner and founder of Kilauea Pest.
We both personally use him for our own homes, and we recommend him to our clients. Actually, there is nobody else that we recommend, and we've mm-hmm. been with, he's been one of our trusted vendors for almost, I don't know, 5-6 years now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Long time.
The big one, too, is the termite. If you're looking for a good termite partner for the inspections, if you're in real estate, homeowner.
And they, you know what? They guarantee their work. Just like Duke was talking about that.
Yeah.
Like, there's just not a lot of the property managers that will guarantee their work. Kilauea guarantees their inspections.
Yeah. They're like, wow, how was your experience with Kilauea Pest Control? Oh, it was killers. That's another domain he got to go get. Killers Pest Control. That's it. John Speed. We know him personally, too. He's a really great guy, and everything flows from leadership. And so I think it'd be a great company if you're somebody out there looking for a job.
And before we end the show, I just want to remind our listeners, go to helpingoahu.com.
Yes.
We're looking for two more families that we can help. So we'll be waiving the list side commissions for two more families that have been...
Some serious COVID... crises, you know, go to our website, fill out the form, we'll call you, go through an interview. We already have one client, we've already got into escrow, helping her get on through a new chapter of her life and taking a lot of stress out of her life. And she'll be on the show a couple weeks.
Well, thank you for listening, and thank you to our sponsors.
Jody Tanga and Derek Tanga, Pacific Rim Mortgage.
Bradley Mariama of Allstate Insurance.
Kenji Vendetta of Pillar to Post Home Inspections.
Janice Merland of Dreamhouse Drafting.
John, Formula One Speed of Kilauea Pest Control.
Duke Kim Han of Hawaii Pacific Property Management.
If you want to get a hold of any of our sponsors, just go to teamlally.com.
We also want to give a big thank you to Leah Rodriguez, our producer here in the studio.
Yee-hoo!
Make sure to tune in next week. We'll have an awesome guest talking about something that'll change your life.
Forever! This is the Team Lally Real Estate Show, home of the guaranteed
sold program.
If we can't sell your home at the agreed upon price and our time frame, we'll have it bought for cash.
Be safe and aloha.
The preceding program was sponsored by